What's up, guys? Nick here with NPM Productions. Today we'll be discussing music notation and how important it is in the music direction process. A lot of my colleagues out here in LA send out charts, master rhythms, and even full arrangements with generated parts in preparation for rehearsals, gigs, and even tours. In a way, we consider these our scripts, our roadmap outlining the flow of the songs, the set, and the show. Charts give us a visual representation of what we're about to play, and can be accessed along with a recording of the existing rehearsal or show to rehearse and review on our own time. Charts can vary in complexity from a simple one-stave representation of the chord changes, rehearsal markings, measure numbers, and lyric cues, to individual instrumental parts with the exact music to be played written out. They can be formatted to segue between songs if the set acts as a medley or has no silence between songs. This is a common technique used in shows these days. They can reflect the click track played in the instrumentalist's ears, showing how many clicks going into a song. They could even dictate tempo changes. They can dictate horn parts and articulations, vocal lines and harmonies, and synth and guitar sounds. Charts act like a universal notepad for the band. A music director can call out start points by rehearsal mark or measure number. Band members can mark up charts to have certain things stick out to them, reminders of things to rehearse, things to program, places to watch the music director, and most importantly, notate exactly what the artist wants, where they want it, without confusion. These are five techniques I incorporate in all of my charts that guarantee ease of the rehearsal process. Number one, accurate tempo markings. It's one of the first things we see on the first bar of the music. It gives us the exact BPM for a song and gives musicians a vast overview of the groove, pace, and flow of the song. It makes Ableton programming or drummer click track programming a breeze if each chart in the set is marked with an accurate tempo. Any further information that you can give us is a plus. For example, slow jam with a strong backbeat, or heavy British invasion punk rock. This will also help in jogging the memory to what that song sounds like. A great friend and drummer of mine turned me on to an app that accurately assesses song tempo. It's called Live BPM. I use this exclusively to assess my chart tempo. Number two, important lines and sample lines. It makes it so much easier on the instrumentalist to have a bit of what they're playing written in the part. Give the bassist that two-bar bass line that is crucial in the arrangement, rather than getting to rehearsal and having them scramble to their phones to re-listen to the groove. Write out a sample guitar line so the guitarist has an idea of what you're going for. Give the keyboardist any lines you would like to hear. Use more than one stave if you need to. The more work that you put into your charts, the less anxious and stressed you'll be in rehearsal. Number three, write in lyric cues. Lyric cues are going to help you immensely when the artist says, "I don't know if it's verse 2 or verse 3, I just know it's when I start singing your eyes." Well, awesome, because now we know that verse 2 starts with your hair, so that must mean that verse 3 starts with your eyes. This also helps when you have odd bar phrases and the vocal comes in after 9 bars instead of 8. I also use this extensively when someone is holding diamonds in a rubato section following the vocalist and needs to know what word to play the next chord on. Number 4, keep everything congruent. If the band is jamming on C minor for 8 bars, put those 8 bars together on the same line and put a little 8 over the last measure so the band knows it's the 8th bar of the phrase. If you have a 6-bar phrase, do the same, or divide it in lines of 3 measures depending on how much information is on each measure. Let the band know about odd phrases. Give them the information to succeed. If a rehearsal marking is in the middle of a line somewhere, you know something went wrong. Number 5, read it like a book. The most important thing to do in chart writing is don't use back repeats, del senos, or codas. These are all valid music notation devices. I'm not disputing that. But in the age where a good percentage of musicians are using pads to digitally read charts, there is no reason to try and keep a chart 1 or 2 pages. Here are 4 reasons why I don't use this technique. Number 1, I've spent too much time in rehearsals specifying that a repeat only gets played 2 times total, or 3 times, or 2 times the first time and 1 time the second time. I'm already confused. Don't do this to your instrumentalists when they already have a million things to think about. Number two, del segnos and codas cause the same level of confusion as repeats. You need to search for the sign and then the coda, or follow your highlights that you made in rehearsal. You need to flip back 2 pages, ahead 3 pages, to save maybe 2 or 3 lines of music rewritten out. Number three, it's way easier for a musician to see that we're going to verse 3 and 4 rather than rereading verse 1 and 2. You can also see the harmonic transition easier into the next section because you're keeping everything in 8-bar congruency. A first and second ending are going to be adding 10 or 11 bars to the end of a phrase, throwing off the ease of reading. Number four, most importantly, a back repeat traditionally means that everything gets played exactly the same again. Very rarely does nothing change between verse 1 and verse 2. There's usually a hit, a harmonic discrepancy, an extra bar, a hold, something musically that breaks it up from verse 1 to verse 2. Don't have your instrumentalist deal with that pesky second time only note in the back repeat. Well, I hope this was helpful to you all. Please reach out if you have questions or if you'd like me to elaborate on anything in particular in this video. Thanks, guys, and stay creative.